Hello, thank you very much, Amelia, for the introduction. And hello, everyone. Welcome to this webinar. As my colleague Amelia said, we will be discussing about designing gate driver systems for silicon carbide devices with the new WE-HDDT auxiliary gate drive transformer series. And the main points that we will cover in today's webinar are the following. We will start with a short overview of the advantages of silicon carbide-based transistors versus their silicon-based counterparts. That will be followed by a review of the gate driver system and its basic operation. We will also learn about some of the challenges that very fast switching transitions present to the gate driver system, together with their solutions. Our focus will be on the isolated auxiliary supply of the system, and we will go through its most important requirements and design considerations. We will also provide a few tips for when designing for very high switching speed, which is in fact one of the main advantages of using silicon carbide devices. After this, we will introduce the new WE-HDDT transformer series from Wurth Electronic, which are optimized for driving silicon carbide as well as IGBT devices. We will also show the validated reference designs available for each of the WE-HDDT transformer. Now moving on, we will learn how simple it is to integrate these reference designs in your application with giving two example DC-DC converter prototype designs. We will then move to the Q&A questions and answers section. All right, so let's start with a summary of the most important advantages that silicon carbide devices might offer. So compared to the equivalent silicon-based devices like high voltage power MOSFETs or IGBTs, those advantages are the following. A much faster switching speed, and more exactly, 10 times faster is being claimed by some semiconductor manufacturers. They can also be operated at higher switching frequency for the same application power, while still maintaining good efficiency. And in addition, their higher drain source breakdown voltage with ratings of the latest devices up to 1,700 volt, then this will allow also for a higher converter operating voltage, which also have some benefits. Additional advantages will be their higher operating temperature capability and good stability with temperature of the on resistance RDSON. Now in a power electronics application, all of these technology advantages will translate in higher efficiency, a smaller solution size, a lower system cost, and overall, a higher power density. However, these advantages also come at a cost. In particular, the extremely fast switching speed together with high voltage operation will present demanding challenges to the gate driver system. This will require a rugged galvanic isolation while being capable to provide very fast drive current peaks and at the same time dealing successfully with increased gate voltage ringing. Additional issues will be more spurious turn-on events of the silicon carbide device, like those caused by Miller effect or by excessive ringing amplitude. But we will see this in more detail later on. Another challenge will be the distortion of the control signals, which might potentially lead to loss of control of the silicon carbide devices. When we learn about this, we will also introduce the concept of common mode transient immunity, CMTI. And during this webinar, we will learn several possible solutions which might help to overcome all of these challenges. But before we dive into the details, here we can see some of the most trending application areas where silicon carbide devices are being increasingly adopted. So we have e-mobility powertrain, onboard and offboard battery chargers for electric vehicles, we have solar inverters for renewable energy, industrial drives, data center power, and general high power switch mode power supplies, and the power factor correction stages. All right, so let's do now some review of the gate driver system. Here we can see a typical simplified gate driver system with the silicon carbide MOSFET and two main blocks, the isolated gate driver IC and the isolated auxiliary supply. In this case, it is a bipolar output auxiliary supply, which is providing a positive voltage rail plus VDD and a negative voltage rail minus VEE. We can see that the isolated ground terminal is directly connected to the source terminal of the silicon carbide device. In this example, we observe that the SiC MOSFET has two source terminals. It's important to note that one of them is for the high power loop of the converter and the other for the gate drive circuit. This is a Kelvin source connection with very low parasitic inductance, which will help to achieve faster and more robust switching transitions of the silicon carbide device. Now, regarding the gate drive IC, the PWM control signal is received from the controller on the low voltage side, and then this is transferred across the isolation barrier where a logic driver controls the output push-pull transistor states. Each of these transistors switch alternately, connecting the positive or the negative voltage rails of the auxiliary supply to the gate of the SiC device to turn it on or off, respectively. We will see in the next slide in more detail this. This was the example for a gate drive system with bipolar auxiliary supply. And here on the left, we can see now the example when using an auxiliary supply with unipolar output. In this case, we basically connect the isolated ground terminal of the supply and the source of the SiC device to the low side transistor of the push-pull gate driver IC output stage. And with this, we can turn the SiC MOSFET on and off with a unipolar voltage instead. Let's have a look now at the switching of the SiC MOSFET in a bit more detail. Here we can see a simplified circuit for the turn on and the turn off of the SiC MOSFET device. We can appreciate here the output push-pull transistor states of the gate driver IC, the isolated auxiliary supply, the positive and the negative output rails with their corresponding output capacitors, as well as the turn on and turn off gate loop resistances and loop parasitic inductances. They are all connected as shown in previous slide. And we notice here that we have replaced the silicon carbide MOSFET with a variable capacitance, right? It's good to know that this is the equivalent capacitance across its gate and source terminals, and it's not the value given in the datasheet, CGS, but it is also considering the gate drain Miller capacitance. And the reason it is a variable capacitance is because the gate charge depends on the operating conditions, like the drain source voltage, which is being switched in the application. Now, during the turn on of the SiC MOSFET, the high side transistor of the gate driver conducts and the output capacitance of the positive voltage rail will share the gate capacitance of the gate source capacitance of the SiC MOSFET to the positive rail, in this case, plus VDD. Equally, during the turn off of the SiC device, now the low side transistor of the gate driver IC conducts and the gate capacitance is charged to a negative voltage level minus VEE. It's good to note that the average current on the positive and on the negative output rails is the same, since the amount of charge, since the same amount of charge is actually flowing during the turn on and the turn off switching transition. However, the peak current will depend on the gate resistance and on the difference between the positive and the negative voltage rails. In fact, we are adding both of them here, so it is actually the delta of the voltage supply. Now, here it should be now obvious that the switching speed depends on how fast the gate capacitance is charged and discharged. So a faster gate current with higher peak amplitude in the end will allow for a faster switching transition of the silicon carbide device. Now that we have refreshed our memory with the operation of the gate driver circuit, we are now representing this system here as a box connecting to the SiC MOSFET device. What we have here is two silicon carbide MOSFET devices connected in a half bridge configuration, each of them with its own auxiliary supply and gate driver IC. The high side device is connected to a high voltage supply, and the low side device is connected to ground. This half bridge configuration is a basic building block of many power electronic applications, like synchronous buck and boost converters, as well as single phase to multi-phase inverters. And most silicon carbide device manufacturers provide power modules with the internal half bridge configuration of the devices. Here, as an example, we can see a simplified three-phase inverter power stage, which is built with three half bridge stages in parallel. This configuration is typical, for example, to drive AC motors. And in typical applications, like in another example, a synchronous buck converter, The devices are turned on and off alternately, and a square-like waveform will be generated in the switch node. This waveform features very high dB by dt on the rising and falling edges, and this depends on how fast the transistor devices are actually switching. In reality, this is not such a perfect square waveform, but it's more exactly a trapezoid-like waveform, since for a pure square waveform, we will need a dB by dt, which is infinite. In the case of silicon carbide devices, since they can switch much faster, the dB by dt generated in the switch node during the switching transitions will also be dramatically higher. And this can cause some issues and challenges which the gate driver system will have to deal with and overcome, as we will learn later on. And to put this a bit better into context, here we can see the frequency spectrum of a square waveform with 100 volt amplitude and 100 kilohertz switching frequency. And this is as a function of the rate of rise of voltage when switching. In blue, the results for a dB by dt of 10 volt per nanosecond, and in red, for 100 volt per nanosecond. And this can be, for example, a synchronous buck converter, right? And these results were actually obtained with an LTSPICE simulation. What we can appreciate is how for a higher switching speed, there is more energy in the high frequency harmonics. And this will lead to much easier parasitic coupling effects with the resulting common mode displacement currents generated. In addition to this, LC parasitic resonant tanks, which might exist in the PCB layout, in the component packages, for example, now they will be excited with more energy. And as a result, more ringing will be generated. Now, this might cause some adverse effects in the circuit, like, for example, signal integrity issues, which will compromise circuit operation and even reliability. But in addition to this, this will also cause EMI issues. And in fact, if we look at the frequency spectrum a bit closer, in this particular case, the frequency range where the harmonics have higher energy is from around 30 megahertz and higher. And this is a common start frequency range for EMC radiated emissions compliance tests. So only just in advance, we might know that we might be facing some important EMI challenges there. Right, so let's see next what the auxiliary supply of the gate drive system could do to help to overcome these challenges. Now, before designing or selecting the auxiliary supply of the gate driver system, there will be some open questions which will come into our minds, like the following. What are the requirements for the galvanic isolation and the transformer? Which DC-DC isolated topology is more suitable? Do we need unipolar or bipolar gate drive voltages? And which voltage levels? How much output power is required? Which layout considerations are important when integrating the auxiliary supply into the gate driver system? Right, so we will try to answer some of these questions here. So regarding the isolation requirements, galvanic isolation is required both for safety and also to ensure reliable operation of the circuit. We should not forget that silicon carbide applications feature high operating voltages. These are typically over 400 volts. And in addition to this, we will need to meet applicable safety standards like the IEC 61558-2-16. But isolation is also required not only for this, but also in order to guarantee robust operation and signal integrity, because galvanic isolation will help, for example, to break ground loops in the system. Now, regarding the topology, we will be looking for a simple, cost-effective, and compact solution with good enough output regulation. The primary side regulated flyback topology offers many advantages in this particular application, but also other topologies like the push-pull or the hybrid are commonly used. Regarding the transformer isolation grade, basic insulation is the most commonly required for SiC gate driver systems. And this offers a one-layer safety, but in some cases, reinforced insulation, which provides three-layer safety, is requested, especially for offline or applications with human-machine interface, and also in some cases targeting extended levels of reliability. But as said, basic insulation is the most common for gate drives. When it comes to the transformer design, we know, as always, we want to minimize the the DC and AC resistances, the leakage inductance, and the core losses in order to achieve a higher efficiency. But in this case, the most critical parameter, the most critical consideration that we need to take into account in the transformer design is to minimize the interwinding capacitance. And this is the contribution from the auxiliary supply to the isolation barrier parasitic capacitance of the gate driver system. And here, let's remember the basic equation of a capacitor shown here, because this relates this permanent current with dB by dt applied across the capacitor terminals. This is going to be very useful in the next slides to remember. Right, so let's see next why it is important to minimize the parasitic capacitance in fast switching speed applications. Here we have the familiar hybrid configuration. We have replaced the isolated auxiliary supply and the isolated gate driver IC with their equivalent parasitic capacitances across the isolation barrier. In the case of the auxiliary supply, we remember that this is the interwinding capacitance of the transformer. And here we will look in detail at the turn-on switching transition of the high-side silicon carbide device. Right, so during this switching transition, a very high dB by dt appears on the switch node, to which the source of this high-side silicon carbide MOSFET is connected. Let's remember. The isolated ground of the auxiliary supply and gate driver IC is also directly connected to the source terminal of the silicon carbide device, as we showed previously, and in turn, then they will be connected to the switch node. So in fact, this high dB by dt transition is in reality being applied across the isolation barrier parasitic capacitance. And this is between the low voltage, quiet ground, and the high voltage, isolated, noisy ground. Now this is going to generate a displacement current across the isolation barrier parasitic capacitance, potentially affecting control circuits on the low voltage side. When this happens, erratic or unpredictable behavior might occur, in addition to distortion of the control signals with the risk of losing control of the silicon carbide device. Obviously, this can compromise functionality, performance, and reliability in the least severe of the cases, but this could also lead to catastrophic damage if both switches are turned on simultaneously. Then this is known as a shoot-through event. And when this happens continuously, repeatedly, right, this might lead to important damage, because this is actually shorting the high voltage bus rail to the ground through the both switches. Now, how much each of the silicon carbide devices is turned on, what is the value of the on resistance on each of them, right? That will determine how much current is gonna flow. And this is gonna help us to introduce the concept of common mode transient immunity, CMTI, which is a measure of the maximum rate of change of voltage, dB by dt, which can be tolerated across the isolation barrier before malfunction occurs. This is measured in kilovolt per microsecond or volt per nanosecond, and we can easily observe that a lower parasitic capacitance across the isolation barrier will allow for a higher dB by dt for the same displacement current level, and in turn, will allow for a higher CMTI rating. So a lower interwinding capacitance of the transformer can help to achieve robust operation in fast switching speed silicon carbide applications. Now here we will see a possible impact of the isolation barrier parasitic capacitance on EMI. In this case, we can observe a simplified concept schematic with the low side silicon carbide device of the Hall bridge configuration, for which we have drawn its parasitic capacitances. These are CGS, gate source capacitance, CGD, gate drain capacitance, also known as mirror capacitance, and CDS, drain source capacitance. Here again, we have replaced the auxiliary supply and the gate driver IC with their equivalent parasitic capacitances across the isolation barrier. And we also see a common mode filter with a white capacitor, shunting the common mode currents to earth or chassis, as well as the equivalent inductance of the common mode shock. Right, this is an example of conducted EMI. As we know, we have the very high dB by dt appearing between the switch node and the power ground of the converter. But it is important to notice that a high dB by dt also appears between the PCB switch node and the earth potential to which the chassis is usually connected, right? So this high dB by dt is now a source of common mode currents. And this can be coupled capacitively across the isolation barrier as shown in the image. Now, these common mode currents need to be reduced for better EMI, and for that, we could minimize the isolation barrier parasitic capacitance of the gate driver system. And this is another simple example of why a low interwinding capacitance is important for fast switching silicon carbide applications. So when it comes to the optimal gate drive voltage levels, there is not a unique specification, since it changes from manufacturer to manufacturer, and even for the same manufacturer, this also changes for different silicon carbide device series. Some manufacturers, they specify the optimal gate drive voltage levels in the data sheet, but others, they don't. And some silicon carbide manufacturers, they claim that the gate drive voltage levels can actually have an effect in the long run, affecting reliability and the lifetime of the devices. So the best thing to do here is to check directly with them, even if they don't specify a recommended or a preferred gate source voltage in the datasheet. Now, what it is sure is that this does not put things very easy when attempting to design a universal auxiliary supply for many silicon carbide devices, right? However, there are some gate drive voltages which are more common, like, for example, bipolar plus 15 volt for turn on, and then minus 4 volt or minus 5 volt for turn off. Then another bipolar voltage, which is common, especially in some previous generation devices, is plus 20 volt and minus 5 volt. And we also have, for example, some manufacturers like Infineon with some series where they recommend a unipolar voltage plus 15 volt to plus 18 volt. And then we have particular cases. We have come across them already from some customers who are asking other voltages than this, like, for example, plus 19 volt minus 4 volt or plus 18 volt minus 4 volt. What we observe is that there is a trend towards a lower gate source voltage from the gate drive required for the newest generation devices. But what is important to note here is that we should observe the maximum gate source voltage ratings of the device, because this can be easily exceeded with the parasitic overshoot and undershoot caused by the very fast switching currents, as we will see next. So what is causing the ringing with the overshoot and undershoot across the gate and source of the SiC device? Well, we must appreciate that the gate loop circuit is in fact an RLC resonant tank. And this is a second order system to which a step voltage is applied when turning the device on or off. Now, when we minimize the gate resistance in order to achieve a faster switching speed, we are at the same time reducing the damping factor of the resonant tank, which will increase the ringing and the peak overshoot and undershoot. But it is also good to note that the ringing might also couple to the gate resonant tank from the power stage of the converter. In addition to this, we know that faster switching speed means higher harmonic energy, and in turn, more ringing, overshoot and undershoot. So what can we do to increase the damping, to minimize the quality factor of this resonant tank, right? We can consider different options. Normally, we consider all of them at the same time, depends on how severe is the case, right? But first of all, we should start trying to minimize the gate current loop parasitic inductance first, right? Because we can do that directly in the layout. Now, this is rarely enough. So in practically most of the cases, we will need to also use a ferrite bead. We can use, for example, the CBS series from Wurz Electronics. They are very popular for this. But if this is not enough still to achieve the desired response within the specs, then we will have to increase the gate resistor value. I mean, this will provide the damping, but at the same time, we'll considerably reduce the switching speed. And we want actually the silicon carbide MOSFET to switch fast, because we want to achieve the high efficiency, the smaller solution size. And at the end, if our case is very severe, we will need to find a trade-off. Let's see now some experimental results here. from this concept. So these are, for example, for from a synchronous back converter. And it is actually for the switching transition when the high side device turns off and when the low side device turns on. In green, we can see the gate source voltage of the control device, which is the high side in this case. In blue, you see the gate source voltage of the synchronous device, which is the low side. In yellow, we can see the low side device drain current, and in pink, the switch node voltage. Now we are placed here a severely underdamped response at the gate source terminals of the synchronous device. We observe excessive overshoot and ringing. And in this case, we will need to add some damping in order not to exceed the SICK device maximum rating. Now, on the other hand, we can see a good turn-off transition of the control device on the high side. Yes, we see some small undershoot and ringing, but this is fading after only a couple of cycles, and we can consider this an optimal response, since if we want to completely eliminate the ringing, adding further damping, as we mentioned before, the switching speed will be slowed down as a result, and this is something we might not want for our application. Here we have another example of the negative effects that excessive ringing amplitude can cause in our converter. Now the high side device is turning off with excessive gate source voltage ringing amplitude, which exceeds the turn on threshold voltage of the device when the complementary, this silicon carbide MOSFET, is already turned on. And what this is going to cause is a shoot-through event with the high side and the low side devices. They are both conducting at the same time. And we appreciate this with the current search in the oscilloscope capture. Right, although shoot through might not always be destructive, like in this intentional experimental case, it typically leads to lower efficiency and lower reliability of the application. Now, if the ringing is properly damped, then this event could be avoided. So we have seen here a couple of examples of why it is important to have a close look to the ringing, overshoot, and undershoot, especially when designing with high switching speed silicon carbide MOSFET devices. Good, let's now learn one of the main reasons for driving the silicon carbide MOSFET with a negative voltage for turn-off. We have here again the half-bridge configuration. In the same situation as described before with the high-side switch device turning on, which will cause a high dB by dt appearing on the switch node. Now, another adverse effect from this is due to the displacement currents, which will couple now through the gate drain capacitance to the RLC resonant tank in the gate source circuit. Note that the gate drain capacitance, as we mentioned before, is also known as Miller capacitance, and this is what is commonly known as Miller effect. In addition to any resonant ringing that this might cause, because, for example, as a cause of an underdamped RLC resonant tank, we also have, in fact, an impedance divider, which can be approximated as a capacitive divider if the impedance of the gate source capacitance is much lower than the impedance of the gate resistance and parasitic inductance in our gate current loop. Now, depending on the ratio of the gate drain capacitance to the gate source capacitance, a voltage bump might appear across the gate and source terminals of the device, which could easily make the gate voltage exceed the turn-on threshold voltage, causing again a shoot-through event, which, depending how severe it is, might have only, as we mentioned, a drop in efficiency, lower reliability, or catastrophic damage. Right. We should note here that the risk of this happening will increase with higher dB by dt, thus with higher switching speed of the devices. Now, in order to prevent this, there are several solutions that we can try. Many times, we will need to try a combination of some of them or all of them, depending, again, how severe is the issue in our application. Now, the first one is to make sure that the gate charge, that the charge required for the SICK device to reach the threshold voltage is higher than the Miller charge. This data, we can obtain it directly from the data sheet of the silicon carbide device. Another option, we can pick a silicon carbide device with a higher threshold voltage. right? In addition to this, we can use an active Miller clamp with some gate driver ICs. They allow for this option, they also include it. Or we can simply apply a negative enough gate drive voltage for turn off. And this will provide additional headroom to the threshold voltage. But I say many times we have to apply a combination of these solutions, or even all of them. Now, so we have seen how preventing the spurious turn-on of the silicon carbide device caused by Miller effect or by high amplitude ringing is one of the reasons why we will typically be looking into using a negative voltage for turn-off of the silicon carbide in fast switching applications. Right, so moving on. Another of the open questions that we had for our auxiliary supply, this was how much gate drive power do we need, right? During the switching transitions, power is dissipated in the total gate current loop resistance. And this power needs to be provided by the auxiliary supply. We have seen that to turn the SiC MOSFET on and off, we need to charge and discharge its gate capacitance to the positive and negative gate drive voltages. So we are talking of the energy of a capacitor whose expression is given here. Now multiplying the total energy per cycle by the switching frequency gives us the average power, which depends on the required gate charge, the switching frequency, and the delta of gate drive voltage applied. Now we observe that the average power does not depend on the gate resistance value. However, the gate resistance value controls the peak current, and with it, it controls the peak instantaneous power as we saw before, which will impact switching speed and EMI performance. Now, in addition to this, we should not forget to include in the power budget here the gate driver IC in case part of its internal circuitry on the isolated side is supplied by the auxiliary supply output rails. This happens in some gate driver ICs. And let's see now here an example calculation. So here we will try to design, we will try to find out how much gate drive power we need for this silicon carbide module, the CAS120 M12 from Wellspeed. We have these specifications, a switching frequency, 150 kilohertz. We have a gate source voltage of plus 15 volt for turn on, minus 4 volt for turn off. A delta gate drive voltage will be 19 volt. Now, what is the gate charge? So now we need to go to the data sheet and we will find a table like this, right? What is important to notice here is that the total gate charge that is given in the data sheet here in this section has been measured with some test conditions, specific test conditions. One of them is the delta gate drive voltage. In this case, is plus 20 volt and minus 5 volt. But we remember we want to drive it in this case, in this example, with plus 15 volt and minus 4 volt. So for that, we might look further in the data sheet and we can find this curve, the gate charge versus the gate source voltage. Now from here, we can find that for a auxiliary supply gate drive voltage of plus 15 volt and minus 4 volt, we need 280 nanocoulomb. Now we made the calculation as in previous slide, and we found out that we will need around 1.6 watts of power. But it's good that we verify this experimentally, because as said, data in the data sheet is obtained under some specific test conditions. Or operating conditions in our application might be different. Anyway, it should not be far from this calculation. Here in this table, we can get a feeling of the required gate drive power for common combination values of the gate charge, the gate drive voltage, and the switching frequency. Now we see as the application output power increases, the total gate charge of the silicon carbide devices will also increase, since a lower RDS(on) will be required, or just because we will need to parallel several devices. Also, if we are targeting a smaller solution size by operating at higher switching frequency, or if we are targeting higher efficiency, and to achieve that, we apply higher gate drive voltages in order to achieve faster switching speed. All in all, the required power can range from less than 100 milliwatt for the lowest power applications using discrete devices, up to above 6 watt for high power applications using silicon carbide modules. And in some specific very high power applications where several silicon carbide modules are paralleled, the gate drive power can increase even further due to the increase in the total gate charge. Let's go now through a few tips for designing for high switching speed. If we want to design for faster switching speed, here are some of the considerations we will need to take into account. First, we can increase the gate drive voltage swing, the delta. We should minimize the gate current loop resistance. We should minimize the gate current loop parasitic inductance. Now we should select a gate driver IC with high enough peak current strength. If we cannot find it, based on our calculations, then another option is to use an external push-pull transistor stage external to the gate driver IC, which will allow for higher current strength. Another consideration is to choose a silicon carbide device with very low gate source capacitance and gate drain capacitance. Also, it is important to select a silicon carbide device with very low internal gate resistance. This value is important because it might be several ohms on value and might really slow down the switching if not chosen properly. It might be easily overlooked in the datasheet. Another consideration is to use a 4-pin silicon carbide device with the additional Kelvin source pin. Right, a common phenomena in switching power converters is the current spike which appears on the inductor current. We can observe this on the oscilloscope easily. This happens, for example, during the turn-on transition of the control or high-side silicon carbide MOSFET device in a buck converter. And this phenomena gets worse as the switching speed increases, causing EMI issues. Now, the current spike amplitude can be limited by reducing the parasitic parallel capacitance of the power inductor of the converter. However, in many high power, high voltage applications, switching at a lower frequency, this is not always feasible, as the inductor requires high inductance with a high number of turns, typically using a toroidal core. Now, in this case, a solution would be to add a smaller inductor in series with much lower inductance and parasitic capacitance. In this way, the total combined parasitic capacitance will approximate that of the small inductor, and the current spike amplitude can be reduced considerably. Now, here in the image, we can see an example size comparison of the two inductors in a high power converter. In this case, both inductors were designed by the custom magnetics division of Wurth Electronic. So if you have any requirement, please do not hesitate to get in touch with us. We might be able to help. And by the way, these two inductors, you can already find them on the website, at least the bigger one. And here we can see some experimental results. On the left, without a series inductor, and on the right, with a series inductor. You can observe how an additional small series inductor with very low parasitic capacitance actually can dramatically reduce the current spike amplitude. Right? So now that we know the main requirements for the auxiliary supply, let's find an optimal solution. And for that, Wurth Electronic has developed a new series of transformers which are optimized for fast switching silicon carbide applications. They can also be used for driving IGBTs and silicon power MOSFETs alike. They come in a tiny EP7 form factor with extremely low interwinding capacitance down to 6.8 picofarad, right? This is less than half of comparable regular transformers, which will allow for higher common mode transient immunity. We have learned how this is key for fast switching silicon carbide applications. They also feature up to 4 kV dielectric insulation, and they are compliant to relevant safety standards like the IEC 62368-1 and IEC 61558-2-16. They are also SEQ200 qualified for higher reliability. They feature different unipolar and bipolar output winding configurations and can supply up to 6 watts of power on a primary side regulated flyback topology. They are surface-mount devices, pick and place ready for assembly automation, and on top of that, ROHS, a halogen-free and REACH compliant. You can find more information on the link shown here down on the right. The WEAGDT, they have been designed for a primary side regulated flyback topology. This is a popular topology for gate drive auxiliary supply. And some of the advantages that the flyback provides in this application are a small solution size with low component count. It also provides regulated output voltages from a wide input voltage range. Also good efficiency. They also allow for flexibility of output configuration, bipolar or unipolar. And it's also easy to adapt the output voltage levels. Now, in addition to the WEAGDT, there are also dedicated IC controllers for this topology from major semiconductor companies. Like for example, we have the LM5180 from Texas Instruments or the LT83 series from Analog Devices. In addition to this, validated reference designs are also provided. Right, so there are at the moment 6 transformers which form the WEAGDT series. They cover an input voltage range from 9 volt to 36 volt and bipolar output voltages of plus 15 volt, minus 4 volt, as well as adjustable unipolar voltage from 15 volt to 20 volt. 4 of the transformers, they have reference designs with the LM5180 controller from Texas Instruments. This is the PMP30629 with an output power up to 5 watts. There are also 2 of the WEAGDT transformers with reference designs from Wurz Electronic using the LT8302 controller from Analog Devices. They provide, in this case, up to 6 watt output power. Now, the bipolar reference design with the LT8302 with plus 15 volt, minus 4 volt output is already released, but there are more reference designs currently in testing phase, which will be released very soon. Have the unipolar output version, up to 6 watt of power, and additional bipolar versions, for example, for plus 20, minus 5 volt, or plus 18, minus 4.5 volt. If you have another specification, we will be happy if you let us know, because we might be also able to help, possibly, release a new reference design. And here we can see an overview of the reference design RD001, which we were talking about. This is extremely compact. It's 14 by 27 millimeter. And you can see here in the image how it compares to a 1 euro coin in area. The input voltage range is from 9 volt to 18 volt and, as we say, bipolar output voltage plus 15 volt minus 4 volt, up to 6 watt of power with peak efficiency of 86% and an isolation barrier parasitic capacitance down to 7 picofarad. Now, this is provided in 2 layer variants, 1 2 layer design with components only on top side and other a 4 layer design with components on top and bottom sides. The PCB layout and fabrication files are available on Wurz Electronic website, as well as supporting documentation like a detailed reference design document, RD001, and an application note, in this case, the ANP082. They are all available to download for free on the website from Wurz Electronic. And here we can see the good output voltage regulation of this reference design for the positive and negative rails. It's from half a watt to over 6 watt output power. Right, so let's see now some examples of how to integrate the reference design in the gate driver system of typical application. Now, the first example is a high power synchronous DC-DC converter using discrete silicon carbide MOSFETs, which can be configured as a buck or as a boost converter. The output power of this converter is in the lower kilowatt range and the input voltage is 400 volt. This is scalable to up to 800 volt. It is an open loop operation with the PWM control signals being applied externally. And this is simply an experimental prototype designed in Burda Electronic, mainly for internal evaluation of the WEIGDT reference designs, but also for evaluation of many of the company's passive components. And here is an image of the board. We're gonna paste it, the gate driver system with the auxiliary supply, the high, for the high side and the low side, and the gate drive IC controller, in this case, the UCC21710 from Texas Instruments. We can also see the half bridge, the two silicon carbide devices with the heatsink, and the input and output power stage. Now, Burda Electronic can offer many components for this type of applications, and here, as an example, we find the FTVP film capacitors, the FTDB DC link power film capacitors. They are not released yet, but they will be released very soon. Also, we have high power choke, the mid FLT, also a custom power choke, the series inductor that we already talked in previous slide. We also have preset, the reference design RD001 with the AGDT and the multi-layer ceramic capacitors, the CHGP. We cannot forget about ferrite bits for ringing control of the gate source voltage. Have a magic FDSM power module. This is basically to step down the voltage from the input voltage 12 volts down to 5 volts, which is required by the gate driver IC. And now connectors, there are many options, TBL, the pin headers, PSD, and also for high frequency measurements, the SMA connectors from Burda Electronic, as an example. Now also coming soon, the new thermal insulator pads, TINS, with thermal conductivity 1.6, 3.5 watt per millikelvin, and electrical insulation 6 kilovolt per millimeter. Now this will be offered with shape customization. This will be possible. And if you want more info, it will be released in an upcoming catalog this year later on. And here an example of the integration of the auxiliary supply, the gate driver IC, and the SiC MOSFET. Now the designer can modify the output stage of the reference design as required. You can add more capacitance if desired. You can move things around, right? However, we recommend to keep some capacitors close to the transformer because it is also important to minimize that current loop. Now, obviously we know that the closer the MLCC capacitor are to the gate of the silicon carbide device, the better, right? Because we will be minimizing the parasitic inductance of the kick current loop, right? And for that, as we have done here, we have just added additional high frequency capacitors closer to the gate of the device. And we can see here, the turn on high frequency capacitors and resistance, the turn off resistance and capacitors, the ferrite bits, and also the gate source resistance to keep the gate, to keep the silicon carbide device off, and also the gate source capacitance. This is an external capacitor which might be added in some cases for more immunity. Now, important considerations is to place the auxiliary supply very close to the gate drive IC and silicon carbide MOSFET device. Using low inductance, high frequency MLCC capacitors like the CSGP, and we cannot forget the ferrite bead for damping the gate voltage ringing. I mean, for sure we are gonna have damping when switching fast. In Burda Electronic, there are many series, the CBF, the CBF high voltage, the TMSB, the PBF. Now, depending on what is your the ringing frequency you want to damp, then you will need to use one or the others. You can see in the data sheet, you can find that information. Now, it is important to minimize the parasitic inductance of the kick current loop, right? In this case, we have added a plane for the to provide a very low inductance, very low impedance path to the gate current. In this case, we know that the AC current, especially with this very high frequency, will follow the path of least impedance, not the path of least resistance. In this case, will be just under, below the trace. And if we do this, this is a possible solution. The plane on bottom layer, we will minimize the turn on and the turn off gate current loop area. And with that, we minimize the gate current loop parasitic inductance. And here we have another example application. This is a gate driver system board for a silicon carbide half bridge power module. In this case, it is for the CAS325M12 from Wolfspeed. Now, this design is a bit different than the previous one because now we are not using an isolated gate driver IC. We are using instead a digital isolator and then a non-isolated gate driver controller. In this case, the MDC801. We will see more details later on. And here is the PCB where we can appreciate the high side gate driver and the low side gate driver. The reference design from Burst Electronic RD001. The G digital isolator IC, the isolation barrier, the high side and the low side on and off gate resistors. And in this case, we are using a silicon carbide gate driver controller MDC801 from Mindset. It's got quite a high source and sink peak current strength of 12 amp, 50 nanosecond propagation delay with only 20 nanosecond pulse width distortion. The drive strength can be adjusted. It also features active Miller clamp, disad detection, and many advanced safety features. This controller is not yet available, but is planned to be available in the third quarter of this year. If you would like more information, you can please contact sales@mindset.com. And this design is provided in two layout variants. One, allowing to mount it just on the side of the silicon carbide power module, as shown here in the image. And the other option, to mount it directly on top of the silicon carbide power module. Right? We might achieve a more compact solution. Right, so that was it. Before we go to the questions and answers section, I would like to invite you to an upcoming webinar about designing buck converters with multiple isolated outputs. This will be on the 28th of April at 9 a.m. Central Time in USA and 4 p.m. in Europe. This will be 1 hour live webinar. We'll go through circuit analysis, design considerations, design examples, and experimental results. So if you enjoy power supply design, please don't miss this webinar. So thank you very much for your attention. If you have any questions, as my colleague Amelia already mentioned, please type them in. We will try to answer those questions here. And for this section, the question and answer, I have invited also my colleague Emil Nierges. He is a product manager for the WE-AGDT Transformer Series. Hello, Emil.
Hello, Emil? Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
I can hear you.
Thank
now.
You. Yeah. Hello. Good. Thank you for inviting me. I'm excited to answer to some of the questions.
Thank you very much, Emil, for joining. And right, so let's have a look now. Right, so we have already some questions coming in. Right. Burst Electronics has also some other standard gate drive transformers. Can I use them for silicon carbide or GaN FETs? And how do the new transformer AGDT is better compared to them, right? That's a very good double question to start with. I know that you, Emil, would like to answer that question because you are also the product manager for the other gate drive transformers, right? So I will hand this over to you to start with.
Okay, yes, indeed, this is a very good question. We have in our standard portfolio gate drive transformers. We actually have two series, one quite small EP5 package, but with functional isolation only, while the other design is EP7 package that offer basic isolation with working voltages up to 250 volts RMS. These transformers have been designed so they pass through the control signal for mainly the IGBTs and regular MOSFETs switching devices. and they are not really recommended for silicon carbide and gallium nitride for the signal. While they have been designed for signal transmission, some of the customers have used these transformers as power transformers in auxiliary power supplies in forward type topologies like half bridge, full bridge, push pull, successfully getting up to 2 watts of power. Now, for the WE-AGDT transformer series, we are talking about another approach where we actually look to design a power transformer, so no more signal. To explain, the new technologies, silicon carbide and gallium nitride, they have sometimes needs for bipolar outputs, like Eliazar explained, and they are really very time critical. Therefore, let's say the job of the signal, the regular signal transmission, is taken over from the transformer by the gate drive ICs. While there is no more need for a signal gate drive transformer, we lose that position, but instead we gain a new one, as a driving IC needs an auxiliary isolated power supply. So the AGDT series have been designed to be used in these auxiliary power supplies for silicon carbide and gallium nitride. And we choose flyback topology with primary side regulation. Obvious advantages that we see here is design simplicity with low component count, regulated output voltage with wide input voltage range, and it's easy to implement multiple outputs with just an extra diode and an extra capacitor. We just build up an extra output at the condition that we have an extra winding in the transformer. As Eliazar showed in the presentation, the interwinding capacitance of the transformers plays a critical role in the application and needs to be minimized. But this minimization of the interwinding capacitance comes with the cost of the leakage inductance. The AGDT transformer series have been designed optimally low interwinding capacitance while keeping the leakage inductance in check. As well, isolation voltages or the safety, it's mid here, basic isolation with working with higher working voltages up to 800 volts peak. I hope this answer to the question.
Yes, that was a great answer, Emil. Thank you very much. Right. And we have also another question here. Someone is also asking whether there is a design or transformer for driving high voltage gallium nitride FETs with lower supply voltages. That's also a good question. And yes, we are working on a new transformer for the WE-AGDT series, which will be targeting high voltage GaN FETs. And we plan also to use the primary side regulated flyback topology with the same form factor than our reference design board shown here, right? But we need to take into account that the gate source voltage ratings for high voltage GaN FETs are quite lower than for silicon carbide devices. We might be talking about a maximum rating of 7 volts for some devices, right? So we will be looking at a gate drive voltage. We have seen some driving with six volt, right, from the auxiliary supply in -3 volt for turn off. But it will depend on we might also be using +5.5 volt or +5 volt, right? If you have any special requirements, also we will welcome that you let us know, because we plan to release also a reference design for GaN. Now, but until this reference design is ready, another option that we have seen some designers using is you can still use the primary side regulated flyback topology with the +15 volt, -4 volt, but then, or with a unipolar voltage, +15 volt, and then you add an additional output step down voltage stage, right? This is typically a center supply shunt, right? I mean, we know that this is very inefficient, right? It's not ideal, especially when you are requiring higher gate drive power, right? I would say over 2 watts, this really becomes quite big and inefficient, right? But for low grid power requirements, like below 1 watt, right? This is a feasible option. Obviously, the best option would be to have already the exact voltage rails provided by the output windings of the transformer in a flyback supply. And we are working on that, and we will also be looking to provide this with even lower interwinding capacitance. Now we will, as we saw, if we use the flyback topology, we will be penalized by the efficiency, because if we reduce the interwinding capacitance, we will be increasing the leakage inductance, and in a flyback converter, then we will get lower efficiency. But yes, we are working on that, and hopefully they will be released at some point in the near future. Thank you for your question there. Okay, let's move on. More questions. All right. What other topologies we can find typically for the gate driver voltage supply, and how does the flyback compare to other topologies? Right. Do you want to answer this, Emil, yourself?
Well, yeah, sure. Just to make it clear, when we discuss the topologies, we refer to the auxiliary power supply topology, not at the main high power application. So for the auxiliary power supply, we can see today on the market, like you also mentioned in the slides, half bridge, full bridge, push pull, and flyback. For the half bridge, full bridge, and push pull, they are working typically with fixed 50% duty cycle in a simple configuration without output inductor and in open loop without regulations. They are very dependent on the input voltage and as well of the load conditions. Therefore, the input voltage needs to be pre-regulated, or like a fixed voltage to like a stable value. And as well, the output voltage sometimes needs to have a post-regulation. The flyback primary stair regulation, as it says, regulation there have the advantages that is running in a closed loop and adjust accordingly the duty cycle to compensate for the input voltage and output load changes, therefore regulating the output voltage. I think this answered to the question, like, between the difference between those two.
Right, thank you very much, Emil.
Yep.
Right, so let's move on with some more questions. Right. Another question, do you plan also design a new transformer or reference design with more dry power, higher than 6 watt? Right. Good question also. Yes, this is possible to do. I mean, we have, from the feedback that we got from customers in the market, I mean, we see that at the moment, up to 6 watt is actually covering almost all the applications, right? Many applications still require lower power, like 1 watt, 2 watts, right? But we saw in the previous slide, even when you are working with high power applications, now you are paralleling silicon carbide power modules, right? You require around 6 watt for that. So we plan it, we have it on the roadmap, right? But at the moment, we are focusing on power levels which are up to 6 watt. Now, a good question here is how much bigger the transformer will be for a 10 watt solution. I think, Emil, do you have something to mention here?
Yeah, I would say that 6 watts of power could satisfy the majority of today's applications with good reserves. But let's say if a 10 watt solution is required, we will probably need to consider a step-up package like EP10, EP13. And looking at today's reference designs that we have, I would say it could be feasible with minimum impact on the size.
Right, thank you very much, Emil. Yep. So let's move on, other question. Right, someone is asking, is it possible to get some samples of the reference design board? Right. At the moment, we are not providing, we are not kind of selling this or giving this away as a already built module, but we provide for free the PCB layout files, and we provide for free also the fabrication files. So at the moment, the answer is no. We cannot provide samples of the already built board, but I mean, all the design files are there to download from the website, and this is something that at the moment it will need to be done by the designers themselves. Hopefully, maybe in the future that might change. If you really would like to have this board, please let us know, because really we really receive many requests from customers for this. Then this, of course, we should consider this option also. Right, so let's move on. More questions. Right. Another question: is the transformer basic insulation? Is it possible the same design with reinforced insulation? And how much bigger the transformer will be? Right. I will hand this over to Emil.
Yeah. Yes, these transformers have been designed to meet basic isolation with working voltages up to 800 volts peak, 570 volts RMS, according to 61558-2-16 and 62368-1. You also mentioned there in the slides. While most of the applications needs up to basic isolation, there are some that may require reinforced isolation. And for those particular cases, we need to look at bigger packages that offer the needed higher creepage and clearances. If there is some specific requirements that who asked this question had in mind, please feel free to contact us. And we will do a detailed evaluation and figure out the best options.
I think, Emil. Right, more questions. We have, is it possible to design gate drive supply transformers for the power levels mentioned with interwinding capacitances below 2 picofarad? If not, why? And what will be the coupling coefficient for an interwinding capacitance below 2 picofarad? Right. I know, Emil, you are really looking forward to answer to this question.
Yeah.
We already talked about this before here.
Yeah, it's a very good question. And this is the trend that we see on the market as more speed is coming in. Is if today we look at around of 100 volts per nanosecond or 100 kilovolts per microsecond, I start to see or hear numbers like even 300 kilovolts per microseconds, which is quite a lot. And then everyone start to look at the transformer as being the issue there with the capacitance, interwinding capacitance. And there are some IC manufacturers that are starting to ask for those levels, like below 3 picofarads, 2 picofarads, and even lower than that. What I can say as of today, there are some projects that we are working on it. We are actually targeting those levels, like 2 picofarads and even below. Unfortunately, for a flyback topology, it may get out of its range. Why? Because we need to use other techniques to increase to make a bigger separation between the windings, between primary and secondaries, and therefore we will have a much higher leakage in inductance. We will have some trials, but the rate of success probably is not so much. So in order to achieve those low interwinding capacitances, most likely we need to switch to another type of topology. Similar to bridge, full bridge, half bridge, where the leakage doesn't play so much overall, and then we can do this type of transformers. It's not so much of a secret there. The way we achieve those low interwinding capacitances is by splitting the primary, separating the primary from the secondary, by really having them apart, winded. So that's something that will come up in the next time. I don't want to promise too much. We target by the end of the year to have something coming up, but we may encounter some delays, but we will have something to get as low as, let's say, 2 picofarads solutions.
All right, thank you very much, Emil. More questions. In summary, what are your most important recommendations? This is quite a general question, but we will try to answer. So once you have, I would say, what you have designed your silicon carbide or IGBT application, you have your converter there. Now, obviously, you know what you want to optimize, right? You want to optimize for highest efficiency, smallest size. So if you really want to switch really fast. Now, if you want to switch really fast, I would say, start kind of observing what is actually the behavior of the converter, which issues you have. Do you have excessive overshoot, undershoot, and ringing that you really need to damp? Or how much is that going to slow down your switching speed, and how much that is going to affect your efficiency on your converter? Now, let's say that you have solved that problem, the problem with the overshoot, undershoot, and ringing. You don't have any other more problems, then you are fine. Now we have also received some contact from customers that they are having issues with some unpredictable behavior, right? So what we discussed, it might be caused by the Miller effect, spurious turn on, right? For which we have seen the different options that we have. Applying a more negative voltage is one of them, but obviously, if you apply a too negative voltage, you might end up exceeding the maximum rating. So there is a limit on there, and then there are other options like the ratio between the gate source and gate drain charge of the device, and also using an active Miller clamp, right? So you will another option to select a gate driver IC with active Miller clamp, right? And this might solve the issue if it is actually caused by Miller effect spurious turn on. Now, if the issue of unpredictable behavior is caused by a very high dB by dt, so not enough common mode transient immunity, right? So then you will need to look to select a transformer on the auxiliary supply in a gate driver IC with even lower parasitic capacitance across the solution barrier. So first we need to characterize, see what are the problems in our converter, and then we can find the solution in a systematic way. And I hope that answered the question, because it's a general question, what are the most important recommendations? So, but first we should try to switch as fast as possible if we are targeting the highest efficiency and the smallest solution size and overall system cost. And then step by step, we will be solving the issues we might have, as we have mentioned in this presentation, right? So there is still more questions. We can carry on. To reduce the interwinding capacitance, have you considered different transformer designs like the planar? I think, Emil, this is a good question for you.
Okay, yeah, of course, when we start doing these designs, we consider different options, including planar, but we need to take a bit of what are the possibilities in our side, what are, let's say, our expertise, and our expertise is basically wire wound type of solutions. From this one, from the technology that we have available, and especially we were looking at something that we can produce with our existing machines as best as possible. And looking at today solutions that we produce quite well are a solution in EP package, EP7, EP13, EP10. We have very well trained people there, and then automation processes. And the way we designed this part was to have as much as possible automation, so to be as reliable as possible and as well cost competitive on the market. While looking at the planar solution, As of today, no matter how much we look at it and no matter how we look at the automations, I think the price is going to still be an issue. So from, let's say, the cost of, reasons and technology available, what we have, we choose to go with the EP type of package instead of planar.
Thank you very much, Emil, for your answer there. Right, we're going to answer another question. Right, can you talk about the trade-offs between parasitic capacitance, isolation rating, and leakage inductance from the transformer construction point of view? I think this is another question for you, Emil.
Yeah, I think we kind of mentioned already some of them. Yeah, so the leakage inductance and the interwinding capacitance go against each other. So if you want to have very low interwinding capacitance, then your leakage inductance get higher, and then reverse. If you want to reduce the leakage, then the capacitance will increase. So it's a bit hard to find a trade-off between those, but of course we needed to look at different packages that has the, let's say, the best let's say like EV packages, one of the has the best magnetic path line closed, like the line are closed in the core, nice, and playing around with different internal constructions, like the distances between primary and secondaries, number of turns, playing with the inductances, saturations, looking at the market, what ICs are available. We fine-tuned this transformer series around the available ICs that we found on the market, and make sure that the capacitance, which is the main criteria that we are looking into it, is within the parameters. Our target was to be below 10 picofarads, and actually we went even better, like 7 picofarad. While the leakage that we add on with this, it can be handled quite well by the topology. So that's what we did. I hope this answered to the question. To mention about the safety, yes, safety is also important. But in this case, yes, of course, we needed to use a special wires, and those actually make a bit more distance. So normally will help for the interwinding capacitance by using higher isolation wires. But again, it's the leakage that we also need to consider. So safety, we needed to use a special wire. And as well, we had the target of the capacitance to be below 10 picofarads, and whatever we could gain with the leakage to make it feasible for the application.
Right, thank you very much, Emil, for your answer. We still have some questions, but I think we will answer them after that. After this webinar in the coming days, we will answer all of the questions by email. And thank you again. Thank you very much, everyone, for attending to this webinar. And thank you, Emil, for participating in the question and answer section.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And now I will be handing over to my colleague, Amelia. She still has some information for you. Thank you and have a good day.
Thank you very much, Emil. And thank you, Elazar, for presenting and answering very many questions. Now, if you have more questions, maybe you think of them later or we didn't get to them today, feel free to ask them at Here For You. That's H-E-R-E, the number 4, Y-O-U, at we-online.com. Here For You at we-online.com. Thank you again for joining us for today's webinar powered by DigiKey Electronics. And don't forget to register for our next webinar. It's Protecting Your Application and Yourself Using Optocouplers, coming up February 24th. Register online at www.we-online.com/webinars. Thank you and have a great day.